Good morning. So this talk is about it's kind of on the margin of the intended topics about Kolmogorov complexity, because I tried to limit the topics to somehow issues concerning finite sequences or finite objects, and you can argue that this is about finite objects, but probably the intention is to use the concepts involved more about more for infinite sequences. But nevertheless, so it is mainly the story of kind of a technical challenge in finding out about the relation of two different kinds of complexity. So but I hope it will be interesting still. Oh, maybe this one also needs turned on. It's not too important, but generally it would click. Well, so I will recall what we talked about, Sasha and I talked about in earlier lectures, that it makes that an interesting quantity in algorithmic information theory is the so-called a priori probability. Now, in this lecture, I will use as our finite objects that we are trying to characterize, not binary strings, but it's more convenient to use strings of natural numbers. But it doesn't really matter, right? Any kind of discrete set of finite objects can be just encoded into each other. So we will deal with strings of natural numbers. And the kind of complexity that I will talk about is, well, again, very closely related to Kolmogorov complexity, quantitatively also, but not exactly right. So I will talk about prefix complexity and then yet another version. So, and you may just recall that we defined the complexity with the help of some kind of decompressor machine. Right, and when it is when we talk about prefix complexity, we can say that the machine we are using is self-delimiting. Right, it has an input tape which is infinite, but has zeros and ones. The machine reads these input bits one by one. At some point, it stops. It says enough. And outputs the result, right? And now, just for future reference, we may actually introduce a kind of inverse left function for any output element x. We can introduce the set of all those strings from the descriptions that can be interpreted or decompressed into x, right? And so we call this B of x. And so then this must be a prefix-free set now. Okay. And so I mentioned so algorithmic probability was mentioned several times in the last lecture. So let me recall two possible definitions which turn out to be equivalent. So one of them is that you are looking at just a weight distribution over all our objects. Sum of weights must be less than one, and these weights must be semi-computable from below. It can be, it must be approximate from below. And also, if this distribution has also the property that it is within a multiplicative constant maximal among all such distributions, then I mean we can choose one of these and call it the a priori probability. But as I said last time, there is also a kind of more interesting definition that leads to the same objects, namely, take our self-delimiting machine and run it on an infinite tape which just contains a coin tossing sequence. So this is what we call, like, not monkey at the typewriter, but monkey at the computer terminal, and look, take the output distribution that you get. And that will, it turns out that will be such a universal distribution. Okay. So in formula actually, right, so there are two ways to write this. One, you can say that m of x using this monkeys and the monkey and the typewriter formulation, right, so the probability that a of pi is equal to x, or using this definition of b of x earlier, so it is just the set of codes of x, since on this prefix free set we just sum up 2 to the minus the lengths, right? Now we also mentioned prefix complexity earlier, so this is a version of Kolmogorov complexity which, right, then on a universe on an optimal prefix machine is defined like this. It is the minimum length of program, right, in this inverse set. And so now from this picture you see also then there is one obvious relation between a priori probability and complexity, namely that complexity is at least as large as a priori probability. Better seen, 2 to the minus the complexity is just one element of the sum, which is a priori probability, which is m of x. Right? So there is no reason to believe that these two quantities should be close to each other, right? It happens to be the case, right? So it happens to be that this one element, in case where our machine is indeed optimal machine, in this case, this one element is within a its size is within a multiplicative constant of the size of the whole sum, right? So this theorem, right, is also can be called the coding theorem, saying really that these two quantities, the prefix complexity and logarithm of the a priori probability, are equal within an additive constant, as always. This is was also independently discovered by Chaitin. So now I will. My lecture will be mainly about an attempted extension of this relation to some other also interesting notions of complexity and a priori probability, right? I would say that the interest, at least to me, is mainly in the technical challenge. It leads to some other, some kind of combinatorial problem. Now, yeah, yesterday actually, Kolmogorov Shagin talked about, for example, a related result by Solovey, in which now one considered complexity and probability not of finite objects but of enumerable sets, and there again this question was asked: how about how is the complexity related to a priori probability? And it is a curious fact that Bob Solovey found only that complexity is within 3 times the a priori log a priori probability, and up to now we don't know whether the real multiplier is 3, 2, or 1. For finite sets, Vereshchagin showed it's 2. It's up less than 2. So we will talk about another kind of complexity, which is also natural. But so let's just understand also where the technical part of this first result is to begin with. So first of all, if we replace the a priori probability distribution with a computable one, okay, then the fact that complexity is equal to is less than the log probability just follows from this is just the Shannon-Fano code. Essentially, you can just you can just encode strings by length variable length code, which is like a log probability, and then you can that code can be used as a for the decompressor.
Yeah.
Yeah. So, good question. So, just as what you would imagine. But so, what it means is that for any string and for so there is a procedure that for any string and any epsilon. We can output you the probability, compute you the probability of that string within that approximation epsilon. So there is we call a probability distribution computable when there is a program that can approximate it to any desired approximation.
Will be computable, just if you don't introduce some parameter which is not computable.
So let us say, so for example, take in case for infinity, we are talking about here discrete distributions, so just take an example, it's a simple example, just even for a simple coin toss, right? If the bias of the coin is a computable real number, the distribution is computable. It's not. But what does it mean, a computable real number? Again, when there is a procedure that of course the rational numbers are all computable, but pi is also computable. There is a way to approximate it, and so on. As I say, if the probability distribution is computable, then complexity can be certainly bounded by the log probability, not a problem. But the problem is that a priori distribution is not computable, so it's not that simple. But still, this theorem is true, and it has a rather simple proof. I think we'll get to at least the idea of the proof later. But now this is a more full slide, and we want to jump right away to a generalization of prefix complexity. So prefix complexity it had the idea that once a description gives you is available to you for a certain object, okay, extension, then extensions of that description shouldn't give you something else. Well, it's if our objects have some kind of structure, like the objects are strings, let us say, right, a tree of strings, then it makes sense to instead consider descriptions also that have structure. So allow a decompressor which has the property that from longer descriptions it produces longer strings, right? And so the idea is then simple. Well, let's consider some kind of machine which is monotonic. So it has a one-way input tape, binary input tape, and again has an output tape on which you get out an output that's potentially infinite. Now, for convenience, I allow natural numbers in each of the squares, and or somehow delimited from each other, and so it the machine reads input and produces a string output, an output from longer inputs it produces longer outputs, may run forever or may just stop, keeps writing, so we can. We can then define again for every string, particular string X, right? We could define again the set of its kind of the set of its descriptions, which are the set of those binary strings which let the machine output X, but such that any prefixes of these binary strings don't yet output X, right? And then this set is also a prefix-free set. Oh, I shouldn't do that. We can define now monotonic complexity as the smallest, as the length of the smallest string, right, of in the descriptions of X in this sense, right? So this is this complexity is quite related again to the complexity to Kolmogorov complexity. So I'm now not discussing right away the inequalities, but it's really not quite the same because we are not requiring the machine, for example, to stop and indicate the end of our string, right? So the idea is that the complex. Another way of saying what this is, one can say that the complexity is the length of the shortest string that produces an output that extends our string X. But it may happen, for example, that so look at the string zero that consists of all zero, right? No matter how many zeros it consists of, there will be a constant length program that will produce that, because there is a constant length program that produces an infinite sequence of zeros, right? So it's not exactly the say in this case this monotonic complexity of any string of zeros is constant, is not log n like it would be with Kolmogorov complexity. But anyway, so we will see that it's a complexity that has a quite useful role in characterizing randomness. So again, there is an optimal monotonic compressor. So therefore, we can delete the subscript and just talk about monotonic complexity, right? Also, you can view this as an extension, just a generalization of ordinary Kolmogorov complexity. ordinary prefix complexity, because if you look at just strings of length 1, now these are natural numbers, because we are talking about strings of natural numbers, right? And all those natural numbers would then, for them, the monotonic complexity would be simply equal to the prefix complexity. And of course you can do the same thing for things of any fixed length. So in general, on any prefix set, the two concepts essentially coincide. Once we have talked about monotonic machines, we can also talk about a priori probability again on these machines. So again, you can take the monkey at the terminal. So look at what happens when our monotonic machine is running on an infinite coin tossing string. And again, you can define the a priori probability as the probability of the machine extending our string X, right? And again, this can be written as a sum, right? Just as before. This function is interesting. This is not a probability distribution, right? Already as a priori distribution on the ordinary a priori distribution on a discrete set was not probability distribution because the sum of all the weights was less than one, was not equal to one. You can view this as something like a probability distribution, but instead of additivity here, what you have is super additivity, right? If you look at what is the probability of outputting a string, right? And if you look at the probability of outputting each of the extensions of the string, right, then the sum of these probabilities may be less than the probability of outputting the string. Why? Because it may also happen that the machine output, with some probability it will happen that the machine outputs just exactly the string X and never goes beyond that, even when it gets its infinite input. It keeps kind of turning and not continuing. So we are looking at functions of this sort, and there is a name for those. We call them a semi-measure. Well, these are all Levin's terminology, right? And so it turns out that again, our a priori probability is distinguished among all possible lower semi-computable semi-measures. It is maximal among them, right? So within a multiplicative constant, right? So that kind of completes the analogy with the discrete case. So we are talking about the natural extension of Kolmogorov complexity for the two objects on a tree, right? And these are the three strings, and these are, so we defined the complexity and we defined a priori probability. And so now the question to which really this talk is addressed and was addressed is what is, are these quantities equal? Right? And again, just as in the prefix case, if you look at 2 to the minus k of x, now it is just the maximum of all elements in the prefix-free set of descriptions of x. And therefore, it's less or equal than the sum. So the question is it still true that it is within a constant factor of that sum? Right. So in one direction, therefore, there is clearly an inequality. So it is the other direction. That is interesting. Now, again, just to appreciate the difficulty, we should talk. We should see the. Or the problem, we should look at just computable distributions. Well, all computable probability distributions are also kind of semi-computable measures, right? It's just they happen to be even computable. But if you have such a computable distribution, then it turns out that you can extend the idea of the Shannon-Fano code and show you can assign a monotonic code that will give you a code word of just within additive constant of the negative logarithm of the probability. So it is again the same idea of assigning intervals to strings on the sub intervals of interval 0, 1 to strings, but in a nested way, right? So if this is probability, let us see, two-third, one-third, for example, and then you may divide, subdivide it again, right? One-third times two-third, two-third times two-third, whatever. So you subdivide the intervals and assign them each kind of, these are not binary intervals, but there is in them a binary interval always. In case of coin tossing, right, you could then assign these, the code word, binary code words corresponding to these intervals. And so that's the general idea of the nested version of Shannon-Fano code. You can do that and it is certainly true that the complexity is less than the negative logarithm of any computable probability. Again, the obstacle is just that the a priori probability is not computable. Right? Now, it turns out that in this case, in this tree case, this happens to be a real obstacle. So anticipating that the two quantities will not be equal. So actually, I introduce a new notion for the ht of x, which is the negative logarithm of the a priori probability on the tree, right? And so, as I say, we know that ht is less than kt, and the question is, how about the other direction, right? So it turns out that there are at least some reasonable estimates between the two quantities, and this is in the inequality here. So first of all, as I say, ht of x is less than kt of x, but okay, we may not know that ht of x is bigger, but it's enough to add quantity equal to just the prefix complexity of the length of the string x. And that it will be so it's kind of a logarithmic quantity, right? About logarithmic in n. It's enough to add that to get an upper bound. Why? Because if you are on just strings of length n, as I said already earlier, just as if you are just on strings of length 1. That's a prefix-free set. That's basically, then you just got rid of all the tree structure. And in that case, it is just the old Levin's result applies, that that a priori probability is equal to prefix complexity. In that, but on, so on that set, essentially, the monotonic complexity is just a prefix complexity. The same argument applies. Okay. So the main result of, that I wanted to talk about is showing that, yeah, you cannot do anything better than this bound. So actually, this can be formulated more precisely in the following way, that if g of n is just any upper semi-computable function, well, k of n is one of those, but let us say if take, g of n is any upper semi-computable function, which would for which this would be true in general, that kt of x is less than ht of x plus g of n, then this g of n must be already as at least as large as the prefix complexity of n, right? So it's really, you cannot do anything better than that. But so in the remaining time, I will try to also give you some arguments showing why this is a such a separation of the two quantities is difficult. And also, this result. So it is kind of slyly formulated for infinite strings of natural numbers instead of infinite strings of infinite binary strings. And there is a reason. Because in infinite strings of natural numbers, we only really have to deal with the tree structure, and the difficulties presented by the tree structure. And in particular, we are able, in our examples, to construct trees which are very, very wide. But if you are trying to translate this separation result to binary strings, then therefore, because the counterexample trees are very wide, then you get binary strings that are binary trees that are very, very long. And so it turns out that for binary strings, the corresponding separation result is much weaker. It's only, so instead of log n, you get only log n, though nobody knows where the truth is, and so this is still quite an open question. But this result is actually a recent result by Adam Day, some 25 years before that. What best was known is just the separation by the inverse Ackermann function. Essentially saying that these counterexample trees for natural numbers were growing as in size with the length as fast as the Ackermann function. So it kind of indicates showing producing the counterexamples is difficult, and so we still don't understand whether the log n is really needed, or we could somehow go up to log n. So
what
I will.
What is your bet here?
Sorry?
What is your bet here?
My bet is log n, but I, you know, I don't know. I spent some more time understanding in Adam Day's proof why the log n is needed, and I kind of understand it, but it may still depend on some of his technique that might still be improvable. So, but I wanted to say a few words justifying also why the monotonic complexity is interesting, and also why the separation is difficult. So for this, you know, again, I already yesterday talked about randomness, but I talked randomness and tests of random and non-randomness only with respect to finite objects, but one can talk about randomness for infinite strings. And again, extending in a more systematic way what I said yesterday, so one can introduce a notion of a randomness test. So it is just like a game against the objects, assuming the given probability distribution. So if you have a computable probability measure Q, then we call a Q test any function that is lower semi-computable. Now it is a function of the infinite sequences, by the way. And its integral, its expected value, is less than 1, less or equal than 1. So, because then, again, you can view this as a kind of betting system against the assumption that the system is random with respect to the string is random with respect to this measure. So we would, we could call then an infinite string simply random when this is this value is finite on it. And now I will simply state without proof something that is, again, it's not hard to prove, namely that we can simply define a universal, well, it's not that easy. As a theorem that is known, that we can actually define the universal test by just a formula. So there is a test that is universal, that is dominating by a multiplicative constant or all other tests. So we can then choose just that test to define randomness, and it could be defined just by this formula, which if you translate into logarithmic form, then it says something interesting, which is again, which corresponds already to just a kind of non-randomness formula we considered last time, that namely non-randomness of a finite string is just kind of the difference between its log probability and its complexity. But now, for infinite strings, we'll need to take the supremum of these differences. Right? So again, just to see what this means in a finite, if the measure is just a coin tossing measure, then this means just the differences between n and the prefix complexity. Right? But this kind of it doesn't look as good as you would want, because as a matter of fact, prefix complexity is quite frequently much bigger than n. It goes up to n plus log n. So somehow it turns out that if you use monotonic complexities, they characterize randomness much more perfectly. So here is a theorem that shows kind of the role of monotonic complexities in characterizing randomness. So here is six different ways to say, equivalent ways to say that an infinite sequence is random. Five ways, right? So one of them is just what I said earlier. Look at the difference of probability and prefix complexity on the sequence, on the segments. The second one is you can do the same thing with a priori probability or with monotonic complexity. But for these two latter, it turns out that actually there are also inequalities from the other side. So simply, even the absolute differences must be bounded. So for any infinite sequence, an infinite sequence is random if and only if the monotonic complexities on its with respect to a computable measure. If the monotonic complexity of any of its segments is essentially, within an additive constant of its log probability, and the same is true about log probability, the log a priori probability, and so in particular, if you look at this character, the last two characterizations, this also shows that with respect to any random infinite sequence, those two quantities, the log probability and the log a priori probability and the monotonic complexity, must be equal, I mean, within an additive constant of each other, right? So if you want to find, want to find examples on which these two quantities different, strings on which these two quantities different are differ, they cannot be stochastic, right? They cannot come, they cannot be of the kind that they are random with respect to any kind of computable distribution. So they must be some of very weird kind of strings, which can also indicates that it shouldn't be that easy to compute. So if you want to understand the rarity of counterexamples, maybe you can look at this, the tree of sequences. You can see that it's kind of hard to find examples on any kind of reasonable vertical path, but also you will not find examples on any kind of horizontal cut. So because you cannot find example of any kind of computable prefix-free set, because there the prefix complexity is simply the same as the monotonic complexity, and then it's equal to a priori probability. Where are we with time?
You have 8 minutes.
Okay, so this was kind of the justification of why the problem is interesting or why it is technically difficult. So now I may try to in the remaining 8 minutes relate it to a kind of combinatorial or game question. Game questions, right? I already mentioned a certain game yesterday. Somehow, as I said, frequently now in algorithmic information theory proofs, games have an interesting part to play, again, because the objects that we are dealing with are semi-computable, so you cannot just plug them in, but kind of you can try to handle them in a sequential way. So the game we are interested in, you can view it in the following way. There is a client and there is a server. There is a client who is giving you revealing you step by step semi-computable distribution, right? Kind of giving you lower approximations, better and better lower approximations, right? And there is a server who is trying to match this distribution with a code, right? Assigning code words to strings, right? So we call this semi-measure here that we are increasing AXT, right? And the code, it's better to think when you are building up our decompressing function, it's better to think instead in terms of the inverse B of X. So because this, you can view this as some kind of storage allocation. You are allocating bins, essentially binary subintervals of the interval of 0-1 interval to strings X, and in a nested way, so that the nestedness of the intervals correspond to the extensions of the strings, right? When the semi-measure of some string becomes large, the corresponding longer bins large bins should be allocated. And when the problem is, right, so, you know, it's kind of just a picture of how you see here, but here I'm just looking at a discrete case, right, not even just the set of natural numbers, the semi-measure is increasing, then you allocate more and more intervals, right? But you see here, even here you see what the problem is, even on this discrete case, right? So when the semi-measure of number 3 increases again more, then we'll have to, you don't have other choice than allocating somewhere another interval for it. And then later you may have to allocate another one, and the client who is our adversary may force you into fragmentation, and you may never be able to achieve that at the end. Still, if the total measure is large, there is one large subinterval allocated to the sequence. And so this is essentially the discrete game. And but it turns out that still there is a way for server to solve the discrete. We can, with a certain redundancy that is allowed here, which we call 2 to the g. It turns out that if this 2 to the g is greater than 4, the server, so in other words, if you are willing to live with intervals 4 times smaller, then you can still, the server can always has a winning strategy. But it's interestingly, if it is just less than 1.5, then not anymore, then the client has a winning strategy. It is really an absolutely uninteresting result, but its proof can be used as a building block for the nested game. But so then the game on a tree is similar, but it turns out there you cannot require, unfortunately, already that a constant redundancy. And so the question is, so the redundancy can be made a function g of n of the length. And then, so basically the theorem says that as long as this the sum of 2 to the minus g of n is less than infinity, the server can gain, can win. But essentially, if it is computable and bigger than and equal to infinity, then the client will have a winning strategy, right? And so, but the whole, so the part when the server wins is easy, because it corresponds, well, it just corresponds to what we said, that we just ignore the tree structure and allocate things separately for each level of the hierarchy. This is, so essentially now kind of should be clear how these games correspond to the relations of monoton complexity and a priori probability. Really, the real question is how tricky a client needs to be in order to play the nasty game. And but I'm afraid that we are about finish. So for that part, we don't have, maybe just one sentence that I can say is that the real problem, so you know, what server could try to do is kind of choose some intervals for a certain string and trying to fill it in slowly. But client can notice this, and client has can have a notion of a reservation and can say that I'm not going to allocate anything to anymore to a string who reserves the big binary interval. I'm going to work with another string. But the problem is that reservations can then be abandoned and kind of reserved intervals reused. And so it is hard to force the server to waste space. So, and the trick that works against this is that client will have to start allocating things working with very long strings and very tiny intervals, and requiring just very tiny intervals, but gradually getting back to shorter strings and bigger chunks and forcing bigger intervals. And in that way, even if you reserved those tiny sub-intervals, those will be useless for you when you need to reserve bigger ones again. So those, from the point of view of the bigger intervals, those will be wasted space, and this will be force you somehow into treating the different levels of the hierarchy on separate parts of the 0-1 interval.
Well, I'll just send this paper.